everyone, and welcome to the third module in Synthetic Biology by the University of Rochester iGEM 2020 team. My name is Emily, and today we'll be learning about Biobricks. So before we get started, here's a checklist for Module 3. You're going to want to explore the article, What are Biobricks? Open Google Form number 3, and also there's an activity for this, which we'll do at the end, called Putting Biobricks Together. All of these can be found in the syllabus. Here's an overview of what we'll be talking about today. We're going to learn what is a biobrick. We're also going to learn common biobricks and what their function are. We're also going to look at, you know, why are biobricks even useful? Why are we talking about this today? And there's this thing called synthetic biology open language, and we're going to talk about how that's useful for communication. So before we continue, I want you guys to pause the video and answer this question in Google Form 3, question 1. And the question is, how can standardizing a process be beneficial? So you can answer this for science. You can answer it for anything. It could be related to business, to schoolwork, but just try and reflect on how standardization can help people and help groups. So let's jump in. What is a biobrick? A biobrick is a segment of DNA that has a defined biological function. Here we have four biobricks, biobrick A, B, C, and D. They're segments of DNA, and as we'll soon find out, they all have a defined biological function. But there's something special about these segments of DNA. They're what we call standardized. What this means is any two biobricks can be combined. And then I can cut them and paste them to a different biobrick and make a whole bunch of combinations of biobricks. To help you understand this a little bit better, let's talk about Legos. So each Lego has the same general structure. And because of that, we can combine any type of Lego to all other types of Legos. It doesn't matter what the full shape is, it doesn't matter the size or the color. They can all be connected to create an endless possibility of structures. So we should think of biobricks as the Legos of synthetic biology, where every biobrick can be attached to all other biobricks. And because of this, we can create an endless possibility of segments of DNA that have unique functions. So just to really drive this idea home, here's the initial DNA segment that I showed you two slides ago. So we have biobrick A, B, C, and D. What I did is I cut out biobrick C and I replaced it with biobrick E. So now, instead of a blueberry smell, I'm producing a grape smell. We were only able to do this cutting and pasting because these are biobricks and they're standardized. So what are some common biobricks? Here are four, and there are way more than four biobricks, but I wanted to go over the ones that you guys are gonna see come up in the reading that you did before here. And if you decide to go into biology or synthetic biology, you will for sure see these ones. The first one is the promoter. What the promoter does is it recruits the transcription machinery, so that way you can turn your DNA into messenger RNA. You might remember this from a few modules ago. We also have the ribosome binding site. This is the segment of the DNA that encodes the part of the mRNA that will bind to the ribosome for translation. Then we have the coding region, and that's the part of the DNA that encodes the amino acid sequence that will eventually turn into your protein. And then we have a terminator, and that's the part of the DNA that causes transcription to stop. Notice how each of these biobricks has a defined biological function. That's what makes them a biobrick. So let's revisit our blueberry smell and our grape smell. And now let's call the DNA sequence by their biobrick names. We have the promoter, we have the ribosome binding sites, we have the coding region, which is different between these two sequences. This coding region gives us the blueberry smell protein, while this coding region gives us the grape smell protein. And then finally, we have the terminators. So why are we talking about this? Why are biobricks even useful as synthetic biologists? Well, it all comes down to the fact that they're standardized. This helps speed up the designing process. So If I'm looking to make a certain type of biobrick, but I see that somebody else has already made it, I can just use that DNA sequence that I know works for a biobrick. I also can share my biobricks with other scientists, so that way maybe they can incorporate it into their research. This also decreases error, because if I see other synthetic biologists who are using these biobricks, these DNA sequences, and they're working for their experiments, then I can be confident that if I use that biobrick, that the DNA sequence will be functional and that it will do what it's meant to do. It also enables communication. Because each of these biobricks has a defined function, and we can call them by different names like promoter, ribosome binding site, coding region, and terminator, I know what those biobricks do. If a synthetic biologist says, I made a biobrick and it's a promoter, I know what that means. That means that it's a segment of DNA that recruits transcription machinery. But there's another way that synthetic biologists can communicate what they're doing, and that's through synthetic biology open language. Synthetic biology open language is a bunch of pictures that describe what the different biobrick parts are. So instead of calling it a promoter, we have a figure that represents promoter. And this helps communicate what's going on with your biobricks across all languages, because they're universal symbols that you don't need to speak any language in particular to understand. So the four different biobricks that we talked about today, the promoter, the ribosome binding sequence, the coding region, and the terminator, all have a picture on this slide. Pause the video and see if you can find them. Did you find them? I circled them in red. These are the pictures that represent the four biobricks that we talked about today. So now, one last time, let's revisit our blueberry smell DNA sequence, but this time, instead of labeling the biobricks A through E, or by their names such as promoter, ribosome binding site, coding region, and terminator, we're going to use the pictures that describe what these different DNA sequences do. So you see, we have the picture for promoter, for ribosome binding site, coding region, and terminator. We're not using any words to describe what these biobrick parts are. All right, so that's the lesson. Let's do a quick review just to make sure that you got it, because we went over a lot today. First, biobricks are segments of DNA with a defined biological function. Remember, the promoter biobrick has the defined biological function of recruiting the transcription machinery to the DNA. You may want to review the slide where we went over the different defined biological functions for the four biobricks that we talked today. We also talked about how biobricks can help standardize synthetic biology and how that can help speed up the design process, decrease error, and enable communication. We also talked about synthetic biology open language and how that can enable scientists across the world to talk about the work that they're doing. Finally, we have the activity for today. So for this activity, you're going to put together some of your own biobricks and see what the output would be. What would the function be of this DNA sequence if you put different biobricks together? And how could you change that function by cutting and pasting in a new DNA sequence or a new biobrick? So if you look at the example over here, I made a DNA sequence, the blueberry smell DNA sequence. And the promoter that I used, we go to the biobrick bank, was promoter A, and that has medium level transcription of gene, which means I'm gonna get medium level of blueberry smell protein. I also made sure to include the synthetic biology open language symbols underneath each DNA sequence, so that way I could communicate to every synthetic biologist across the world what each of my DNA sequences are doing and what their defined biological function is in my overall DNA sequence. So in this activity, you're going to put together two of your own sequences. You're going to use the synthetic biology open language symbols to describe them without using words. And then in the output section, you're going to describe in words, what is your DNA sequence's overall function? And then after completing this activity, go to Google Form number 3 and answer questions 3 through 5. So that's all I have for you guys today. If you have any questions, just feel free to email us. Bye, guys.